How you doing, guys? I'm Sean. Welcome to Rambles with my camera. Guys, today's ramble, today's video, subscribers question. First of all, can I thank you all so much for your love and support on the previous video? Thank you, guys. I really, really appreciate it. And some of you are interested in this live video we're going to be doing near the end of the week. So watch this space. I'm going to be doing a wee update video. I'm probably going to do videos every 2 days, you know what I mean? Because I'm on self-isolation at the moment. We're talking about getting locked down probably in the next week or so here in Belfast in the UK. So I'm going to be doing more stuff indoors rather than getting out there. So this will be a good crack. So I'm going to be doing a wee video. So thanks for all your love and all your support on this. So this is a question here. It came from Scopinifity. Keith, thank you so much, brother. Sending you guys love. Hope you and your lovely ladies keep them well. Okay, here's a question for you. Compared to when you used to shoot and film, how much post-processing do you do now? Sorry, if it's more, then why? Great question. Those of you who don't know, I used to, you know, when I started photography in 1986, it was all film. What's it, Nick Cormat. This is a newer addition to my collection. But as I say, I had several cameras, a wee Olympus OM2, I had a Praktika camera, Canon F1A, and a lot of film cameras. But basically, I'm sure some of you who are listening are probably not familiar with analog cameras, and don't underestimate that. It's surprising. When I'm teaching photography, a lot of younger photographers aren't aware of it, and it's something that we take for granted, the older generation take for granted, because we took films and we've developed films. I know there's a resurgence in people shooting film at the moment. I have to, you know, have to let you know, obviously, I've done a video about this, but I'm a vegan, so as a result of that, because as films contain gelatin, animal parts, animal bones, I won't be shooting film. And also, and the video will discuss it more, but basically I won't be shooting film. But even if I wasn't a vegan, I still wouldn't be shooting film. And I have shot thousands of photographs in my collection, taken from 86 right up. I just think this day and age, we shouldn't be shooting film because of the chemical aspect involved in it. Because when you're developing a film, the chemicals getting poured down the sink, the printing, when you're starting to print them, the developer, the stop bath, the fixer, all getting dumped out. And in reality, you know, to me, we have to look after the planet. Now, digital photography is not, hasn't got no carbon footprint. Every single thing in this reality has got a carbon footprint. So all I'm trying to do is reduce that. But as I say, as a vegan, I wouldn't be touching the film because obviously the gelatin. But even if I wasn't a vegan, I wouldn't be shooting film. Being there, done it, spent the time, and getting back to your question, I think that I spend less time in post-process in digital than I did in film. Now, there's a couple of reasons for that. Obviously, when you were shooting a film, you had 36 exposure, 24 exposure, even a 12 exposure. But you had the film, shot your film, developed the film, washed it, stop bath, fixed. And basically, you had that. You had to wait till the film dried. That was another length of time. And then you got your negatives, and you had to print your negatives. You might have done the contact sheets, made yourself some contact sheets. And then you got to the print. Now, you know, that all took time. Now you can shoot, let's say for TalkSheet, you were shooting 36 digital images on the computer, plug it in, there you go. Images on Lightroom or whatever you're using. And you can have a look at them. You can scan through them instantly. You can pick a photograph out. I've got a lot of presets already done up. And I'm basically all I've sort of known now the tonal range on an image and the lighting conditions. I'm sort of, you know, I've got a set of presets there that I can use. Instantly the photographs then gets transformed. I can then lighten and darken it. And it depends really on how much work you want to put into an image. If it's an image you'll be putting up on social media, which doesn't require, and it's not taken away from your photography, but just requires a regular image that people can see, you know, that could be done in moments. But if it's for TalkSheet, I'm preparing for an exhibition or preparing for an image to have that I can actually get sales from and I can actually sell on as photographs, then I take a lot more time with it. It really depends on the image. If your image is cracked exposure, you know what I mean, that's sharp. In reality, you know, it shouldn't take you that long. Some photographs could be a wee bit more detailed, You want to darken sections, lighten sections, reduce the soft focus, put more focus on. And it really depends on the image. So I would say genuinely, I spent less time post-processing than I would in a dark room. Because basically when you were in the dark room, and these photographs here, these are all, you know, I printed them. Now they're years ago, but I printed them. But up on there being from the 90s. And I shot, always shot in full frame. And when I say shot in front full frame, it just meant that I always filled the frame, because when I came to printing, I also printed full frame. And in my enlarger, those of you who are not familiar with what an enlarger is, basically it's enlarger is what you put the negative into and projected the image onto a baseboard and onto the photographic paper to print. On my enlarger, the negative carrier, I would have had it filed out. So therefore, I would have had the black line. I would have had the black line around the image, so on top of the negative frame. So I printed, I was very, very good at that. But then when you came to printing, normally the boxes of paper came in grade 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, depending on, but most people would have went for Ilford multi-grade paper. That was a great paper. But a lot of the negatives could have been too soft, or overexposed or underexposed, and it took a lot more work. You might have had to burn detail in, dodge, so you had all the different devices sitting to shade areas. You used to use your hand to let the light go down over a certain section, covering it, shielding it. Now you can do that in the Lightroom, you know, so at moments, and more importantly, you can instantly see the image. Where in the printing stage, you know, the printing stage, you really didn't know. You could only see the negative. You could only see the negative reflection on the paper. It was only when you put that in the developer did the image come out, and you looked at it and you went, nah, it's too dark. Back over again to getting it done. We can do that in moments on the digital. So to me, it's far quicker, and I use less time on the digital than I do in analog. Now, basically, when it came to the printing and that, the multi-grade paper was fantastic. Sometimes you're using a colour head and larger, and you can change the settings in that, which would give you a different lighting when it came to prints. But your box of paper, you could have used multi-grade paper, and then what you could have done was like split grade printing. And what you would have done, you would have, I may go into more detail that later, but basically you were making a print from one sheet of paper, but using different coloured filters until it to get you a tonal range you needed. You don't need to do that now. And to me, like, this is win-win-win situation. Here's contact sheets. If I look at this, and this is possibly where the negative with digital is. With the digital, unlike the film, the analog days, you had 36 exposure, let's say. You limited how many photographs you took. You were a bit more observant with the lighting. Always shot manual. A bit more observant with the lighting, composition, subject matter. You might have came across a photograph and you went, there's a nice photograph. Well, if you only got 36 exposures, you chose whether that was a photograph warranted taking up one of your images. And most times you'd walk past an image. Now with digital, you'd probably been shooting a lot more. You'd walk past a photograph and it might be an average Joe photograph, but in your mind you say, well, sure, look, it's only digital, take it. And I've touched on this in several other videos, but I honestly would rather go home with 20 shit photographs shot on a digital camera and look at them on the computer. I was going to do like on the negative here. Look at them on the computer screen and have 20 shit photographs. Then go home and not take a photograph, like the way I'd done with the film, and always sit and wonder and say, shit, I should have took that photograph. The downside of it is when you were sitting shooting it, you took more. So in other words, maybe if you were covering an event or you're out shooting street, you might go back with about 100 photographs to go through. That can take more time than going through with the 36 exposure. Now, if you look at this here, and I'll do a wee tight video of it, but basically, that's a 36 exposure. It's HP5 Plus, which is 400 ISO or ASA, it's a film speed. And you've got, if you look here, I've only took two frames of that first image, two frames of the second, two frames of the third, couple of frames of the others, and there's one frame, one frame, one frame, two frames, one frame, three frames, two frames, one, two, and one. Where if that was a digital, truthfully, I might have shot 10, you know, of one image. You know, oh, there's an angle there. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Take a photograph. Oh, yeah, no, maybe. Oh, take us over. So we have to watch that when you're shooting digital. And that in itself could, like, you know, you could be looking through 300 images. That takes time. So it's got swings and roundabouts. What I would say is that I've done a video, on two videos actually, on 36 exposure challenge, where I challenged myself to go out and shoot straight and stick to only 36 frames, in other words, 36 images. And that in itself is a good exercise to do, because basically it means that you are consciously aware that you're not just going to fire off 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 images. Keith, I hope that's answered the question, brother. As I say, I would say that my post-processing is less time in digital than in the analog days, 100%, no question of it. And I think the convenience of the digital far outweighs the films. I don't see why people are shooting it. I'm going to touch on that, by the way. I have a fair idea why people are shooting film. There's several reasons. I'm going to do a film. If you want to see me doing a film on why I think people are shooting film nowadays, and me to give like a wee bit of a critique or a feedback on what's happening, let me know in the comments down below. And if you happen to, I know a lot of you guys are shoot film, friends of mine here shoot film, send yous love and yous know my thoughts on it. But maybe it'll be an interesting film. But yeah, there is something magical. Need that sound, man. Wow, you know, and there's something real, you know what, like, I have to say, it brings back a lot of memories, and that's what I would say most people would be shooting film for. It's a nostalgia. And then there's another group of people, because they weren't around whenever film is being shot, they feel that, you know, oh, I want to be like a real, and I've heard that term, a real photographer, I shoot film, that sort of balls. You're a real photographer, you take a photograph while you shoot it in digital or film, you know what I mean? I don't go into that shit, but I've heard it so many times. You're not a real photographer, right? Look at me, I've got a film camera. Fucking bullshit. You still got 36 exposures, and more than likely you're lucky getting one frame out of it, you know what I mean? So let's not point fingers at who's good and who's bad. Don't be knocking the digital brigade. But anyway, that's for a different video, guys. I'm going to wrap this up. Send yous love from Belfast. As I say, if you haven't already done so, please do subscribe. Check me out on Twitter and Facebook and Flickr and my website and things like that. Please hit the wee subscribe button, wee notification bell as well, and we'll get the crack going. And watch out for this video about the live chat. Guys, send yous love. Oh, by the way, trying out the green screen here, so I hope it's worked. If it hasn't, it's still green. If it's pretty shitty, it's the second attempt. I'll give it a crack and see. Guys, send yous love from Belfast. Look after yourselves and look after each other. I was going to say, get out there and take some photographs. Take photographs inside the house. That's a challenge for you.